Speaking of which,
yeah.
You are from Texas.
Yes.
What do you make of the future of Texas politically, culturally, economically? I am in part moving, well, I'm moving to Austin.
Congrats. That's awesome.
But I'm also doing the Eric Weinstein advice, which is like, dude, you're not married, you don't have kids.
Fly everywhere. Yeah.
There's no such thing as moving. What are you moving? You're like your three suits and some shirts and underwear. What exactly is the move entail? So I have nothing. So I'm basically, you know, it's very just remain mobile, but there's a promise, there's a hope to Austin outside of just like friendships. I have it's a very different culture that Joe Rogan is creating. I'm mostly interested in what the next Silicon Valley will be, what the next hub of technological innovation. And there's a promise, maybe a dream for Austin being that next place.
It's that very possible.
Doesn't have the baggage of some of the political things, mm-hmm. maybe some of the sort of things that hold back the beauty of, that makes capitalism, that makes innovation so powerful, which is like meritocracy, which is excellence. Diversity is exceptionally important, but not, it should not be the only priority. It has to be something that it coexists with a like insatiable drive towards excellence. And it seems like Texas is a nice place, like having a Austin, which is like a kind of this weird, I hope it stays weird, man. I love weird people.
I don't know about that, but we can get into
it. But there's this hope is it remains this weird place of brilliant innovation amidst the a state that's like more conservative. So like there's a nice balance of everything. What are your thoughts about the future of Texas?
I think it's so fascinating to me because I never thought I would want to move back, but now I'm beginning to be convinced. So
you hear that, look, Joe? I'm going to send you this clip.
I'm being honest, and many Texans will hate me for this. Texas was not a place that was kind to me, quote unquote. And this is because of my own parent. Like, I was raised in College Station, Texas, which is a town of 50,000. It's a university town. It exists only for the university. So it was a very, I did not get the full Texas experience, is purely speaking from a College Station experience. But growing up, first generation, or I forget what it is, whatever. I'm the first American. I was born and raised in College Station. My parents are from India. Being raised in a town where the dominant culture was predominantly like white evangelical Christian was hard. Like, it was just difficult. And I think of it there in the beginning, I would say like ages like 0 to 8, it was like cultural ignorance, as in like they just don't know how to interact with you. And there was a level of always there was like the evangelical kind of antipathy towards like you being not Christian. You know, my parents are Hindu, like that's how I was raised. And so like there was that. But 9/11 was very difficult. Like 9/11 happened when I was in third or fourth grade, and that changed everything, man. Like, I mean, our temple had to like print out t-shirts. And I'm not saying this is a sob story, to be clear. I've still actually largely for my adult life identified on the political right. So don't take this as some like, you know, race manifesto. I'm just telling it like this is what happened, which is that like we had, it was just hard to be brown, frankly, and to have some of the fallout from 9/11 and during Iraq. And the reason I am political is because I realize in myself, I have a strong rebellious nature against systems and structures of power. Mm. And the first people I ever rebelled against were all the people telling me to shut up and not question the Iraq war. So the reason I am in politics is because I hated George W. Bush with a passion, and I hated the war. And I was so, again, my entire background is largely in national security for this reason, which is I was obsessed with the idea of like, how do we get people who are not going to get us into these quagmire situations in positions of power? That's how I became fascinated by power in the first place, was all a question of how did this happen? Like, how did this catastrophe happen? I realize it's not as bad as, like, you know, previous conflicts, but this one was mine. And to see how it changed our domestic politics forever. And so that was my rebellion. But it's funny because I identified as a left on the left when I was growing up until I was 18. I had also a funny 2-year stint. This is where everything kind of changed for me. When I was 16, actually, I moved to Qatar, to Doha, Qatar, because my dad was a dean or associate dean of Texas A&M University at Doha. So my last 2 years of high school were at this. I went from this small town in Texas, and I love my parents because they could recognize that I had within me that I was not a small town kid. Yeah. So they took me out of this country every chance they got. I had traveled everywhere and constantly let me go. And so I went from school in College Station to like this ritzy private school, American school. Mm-hmm. Best thing that ever happened to me because, first of all, it got me out of College Station. Second, at that time, I had this annoying streak of, I wouldn't call it being anti-America, but you don't appreciate America. Mm-hmm. Let me tell everybody out there listening, leave for a while. You will miss it so much.
Yes.
You do not know what it is like to not have freedom of speech until you don't have it.
Yeah.
And I was going to, exactly. I was going to high school with these guys in the Qatari royal family. And all I wanted to do was speak out about how they were pieces of shit for the way that they treated Indian citizens in that country who are basically used as slave labor. And I could not say one word because I knew I would be deported and I knew my dad would lose his job and my mom would lose her job and that we would be forced out of the country. You don't know what it's like to live like that or to be in a society where, like, you know, you have like a high school girlfriend or something and you can't even touch in public or you're lectured for public decency. Like, listen, I've lived under a Gulf monarchy now, and that turned me into the most pro-America guy ever. Like, I came back so, like, America, like, pro, yeah. I still am, frankly, because of that experience.
Yeah.
Living abroad, like, that will do it to you. Live in a non-democracy. You have, even in Europe, I would say, you guys aren't living as free as we are here. It's awesome. And well, so I love it.
You're ultimately another human being than the one who left Texas.
Yeah.
So, I mean, have you actually considered moving to Texas? And broadly, just outside of your own story, what do you think is the future of Texas? What is the future of Austin?
Yes.
There's so much transformation seemingly happening now related to Silicon Valley, related
That's
to California.
The fascinating part to me, which is that since I left, it's changed dramatically, which is that it used to be like this conservative state where the main money to be made was oil. And everybody knew that. It was a petro state, Houston, all of that. Austin was always weird, but it was more of a music town and a university town. It was not a tech town. But in the 10 years or so since I left, I have begun to realize, I'm like, well, the Texas I grew up in is over. It is not a deep red state in any sense of the term. The number one U-Haul route in the country pre-pandemic already was San Francisco to Austin, okay? So like, you have this massive influx of people from California and New York, and the state, the composition of it is changed dramatically. The intra composition and the outra, so the intra composition, it's become way more urban. It's from when I grew up, Texas was a much more rural state. Its politics were much more static. It looked much more like Rick Perry, like that. He was a very accurate representation of who we were. Now, I don't think that that's the case. Texas is now a dynamic economy, not just 100% reliant on oil, because of its kind of like, I would call it like regulatory arbitrage relative to California and New York, offers a large incentive to people who are more, I wouldn't say culturally liberal, but they're not necessarily like culturally conservative, like the people who I grew up with. That's changed the whole state's politics. Beto came 2 points away from beating Ted Cruz. Now, I'm not saying the state's going to go blue. I think the Republican Party will just change and we'll have to readjust. But the reurbanization of Texas has made it, I'll put it in this way, much more attractive to me than the place that I grew up.
And then from my perspective, well, first of all, I love some of the cowboy things that Texas stands for. But from my perspective, the injection of the tech innovation that's moving to Texas has made it very exciting to me. It seems like outside of all that, maybe you can speak to the weird in Austin. It seems like I know that Joe Rogan is a rich sort of almost like mainstream at this point.
Yeah, right.
But he's also attracting a lot of weirdos, and so is Elon. And a lot of those weirdos are my friends, and they're like Michael Malice, like those weirdos. And it's like, I have a hope for Austin that all kinds of different flavors of weirdos will get injected.
It's possible. You know, I actually think the most significant thing that happened were Tesla moving there.
Yeah.
The reason why is I love Joe, obviously, but like he can only attract X amount of people.
Yeah.
Elon actually employs thousands of people. Yeah. And then you also... Oracle's decision to move to Austin is just as important, because those two men, Larry, was Ellison, right?
Yeah.
Ellison and Elon, they actually employ tens of thousands of people collectively. That can change the nature of the city.
Yeah.
So you combine that with Joe bringing this entire new entertainment complex with the bodies of people who will appreciate said entertainment complex.
Spend money on the entertainment.
Exactly. Yeah. You just remade the entire city.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm fascinated. And obviously there's network effects, which is now that all those people are down there. I mean, if I were Elon Musk, I would donate a shit ton of money to the University of Texas and I would turn it into my Stanford for Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
Let's introduce some competition and let UT Austin hire the best software developers, engineers, professors, and more, and turn Texas into a true like Austin revolving door hub where people come to UT Austin to get an internship at Tesla and then become an executive there and then create their own company in their own garage in Austin, which is the next Facebook, Twitter. That's how it happens. This is why I'm much more skeptical of Miami. There's a whole like tech Miami crew. I'm like, yeah, like there's no university. It's very inorganic. Look, I think Miami is awesome. I just like, I don't know if the same building blocks are there. And also no multi-billion dollar companies which employ thousands of people are coming there. That's the ingredient. It's not just Joe Rogan. It's not just even Elon Musk if he's still operating in California. It's all the people he employs. Yes. I think that is where I think Texas is going to dramatically change within the next 10 years. Alternative to art. It's already become a more urbanized state that's moved away from oil and gas in terms of like its emphasis, not necessarily in terms of its real economics. And 10 years from now, I don't think it will be necessarily the name prop like of the town. The only question to me is how that manifests politically, because it's very possible though, because a lot of these workers themselves are California culturally liberal. You could see a Gavin Newsom type person getting elected governor of Texas or like the mayor of Austin. I mean, look, mayor of Austin's already a Democrat, right? Like, I mean, Joe has his own problems with Austin. It's funny. I remember him leaving LA and I'm like, eh, I don't know. Have you been to Austin? You know, it's not everything it's cracked up to be, you know, necessarily.
But no matter what, you know, a new place allows the possibility for new ideas, even if they're somehow left-leaning and all those kinds of things. I do think the only two things missing from Austin and Texas are two dudes in a suit that sometimes have a podcast, talk a bunch of nonsense and a mic. So let's bring the best suit game to Texas. I hope you do make it to Texas at some point. Thanks so much for talking to me.